All right, guys. Wow, that was awesome. Thank you for coming to Complete Armoring for Cosplay. My name is Amber. I am going to be one of your hosts. Wilco is actually on her way back from my room grabbing something that we forgot, because you never forget anything in your room at the last minute.
Never.
And
what? Always.
Yes, of course. And Pharaoh, unfortunately, will not be able to make it today because he is with Crunchyroll. So if you get a chance, you know, stop by, say hi. We missed you at the panel. All right. So a little bit about who we are and what we do. Those of you who are on this half of the room, if you would like to move, you are more than welcome to, so that you can see what I'm projecting up here. Alternatively, on our website, cosplay.org, there will be a full recording of this panel along with the PowerPoint and any handouts. So if you miss anything, don't worry. We got you covered. So a little bit about myself. I have been cosplaying since I was 16. I have been doing this for 14 years. You do the math. It's not polite to ask a lady her age. I have been armoring for about 5 years. And I have been moving gradually up the materials list. Started out with fabric, moved on to craft foam, Eva foam. Now I'm working with thermoplastics and fiberglass resin. So hopefully I will be able to cover all of those things for you this afternoon. And I will let Kim introduce herself when she gets here. All right, first thing to do when you're building armor, considerations to have. Con restrictions on materials. Most cons won't look at you kindly if you bring metal armor. Mostly because they're afraid you're going to hurt other people with it. Not that you're going to take it off and bludgeon them with it, but that you might actually hit them on accident with it. And let me tell you, being hit with metal armor hurts quite a bit. A lot of cons no longer allow shellac. Shellac is simply a coating that makes something extra, extra hard and durable. So do read up. It's actually about the same thing as prop restrictions. Anything that you can't use on a prop, you can't use on armor. So just look at their website, see what it is they don't allow. Anything else is fair game. Transportation, how will you get it to the con? For anybody who has worn armor, how many in here have actually worn armor of any kind, including just breastplates and pauldrons? Okay, a few. Those of you who have know how hard it is to actually transport your armor somewhere. Armor isn't exactly something you can fold in half and put in a box. Unless you make it that way. Which hopefully I will be able to show you how to do. But you do need to worry, how do you get it there? And unless you're going to throw it away at the con, which we hopefully you're not going to throw away all that hard work that you did after just wearing it once, how are you going to get it back home? Come on in. Storage, where will you keep the stuff after the con? While it is a fantastic idea to put it on a dress form as an art piece for all of your visitors to see as they walk in, you go, yeah, I made this suit of armor. I wear this occasionally. You have to also consider, if you have multiple suits of armor, unless you're going to have a room full of dress forms, which then starts to look a little bit like a D&D dungeon, then you have to figure out where you're going to put this stuff when you're done. Although, if you have a gaming room, that would be an awesome idea. Very atmospheric. Maintenance. You need to be able to keep your armor in a condition where you can wear it year after year. That means keeping it dust-free. That means if you have metal parts, keeping it oiled so they don't rust. If you have foam and you need to keep it in a certain shape to your body, it may mean that you have to heat it up periodically to keep it in that shape, because foam is finicky. Comfort wearability. You can't have a comfortable costume, can you? No. Pain is just part of cosplay. That's all there is to it. No. You can make armor both wearable and comfortable. You may have to sacrifice a little bit of accuracy, because if you look at pictures of armor back in the day, they weren't exactly interested in comfort. They were interested in protecting themselves from being killed. Here at a con, you also want to protect yourself from being killed in the form of glomping. However, there's a little less worry about lethal glomping. So then you just have to worry about making it comfortable. Because wearing armor for 8 hours, yeah, anybody who's worn heels for 8 hours, you got nothing on armor. And of course, durability. Have to think, how long is this armor going to last me? Is it going to last 1 day, 1 con, 1 year, 10 years? Yes, you can build armor that will last you 10 years.
Longer than that.
What?
And longer than that.
Indeed, if you take care of it. As with all things, you know, take care of it, maintain it, it'll last you a long time. Feed it periodically, water it.
Don't feed it.
Yes. Kim, did you want to introduce yourself?
Hi.
A little bit about who you are and your experience with armoring and cosplay, how you got into it.
For starts, you will not find me on the internet, so you just have to take my word for it. I've mostly self-taught because I didn't even start out as a cosplayer. I attended Renaissance fairs, and I did not have the budget to invest in real chainmail, real plate armor, real weaponry. Not only that, but real weapons are no fun to carry around because you can't actually draw them from their sheaths. So I just decided, I had a funny idea that one day, I really like this video game character, I decided I'm going to construct me a Legend of Zelda Link costume, complete with props, finish the props as realistically as possible so as to mislead people into thinking, sir, could you please put that in the sheath? That is not piece tied properly. Oh, plastic. Armor. My first foray into armor was another Legend of Zelda inspired costume. The only actual plate armor costume Link ever wears, which is Twilight Princess, the magic armor. I actually hate the design. It's hideous as hell. But I was like, it's Link. I love the character. It's armor. I want to build armor. So I did do that costume. And there are pictures. It was my first. It's not my greatest. I've since improved. But that's basically how I got my start. Again, take my word for it because I don't have a Facebook or anything like that.
Facebook is evil.
It is.
Alright, let me pull this back around here. There we go. Alright, back to the presentation. Alright, your favorite part, materials. Well, actually, that's not your favorite part. Attachment's going to be your favorite part. What the heck can you build armor out of? Basically, anything that will bend. Not blend. We're not asking, will it blend? Will it bend? Because, of course, we're human beings. We are not 2D shapes. We have curves. Real cosplayers all have curves. And so we need to get the armor to fit. So any material that bends is applicable here. When you gather materials, you need to think of two different sections. The first is when you pattern it out. Ideally, you would like to have a patterning base on which you base your armor. You don't simply want to jump into the project and pray it fits. None of us have ever done that, right? We haven't done a trial fitting at the con, right? So you'll have both patterning products, and you will have whatever you're going to make your final piece of armor out of. You'll probably want them to be similar, because poster board will bend in a very different way than fiberglass mat. And if they're not similar, your pattern will not match your final result. I promise, been there, done that. And like I said, it's helpful to find a material similar to the final product. Same thing goes for if you're sewing, you'll want to find fabrics that are similar too. Common materials, laundry list of stuff, craft foam, Eva foam. Does anybody not know what Eva foam is? There's a few, all right. This is Eva foam. This is what you usually find with yoga mats, puzzle mats, child's napping mats. It has a flat side and it has a pattern side. Nice and hashy. Sometimes you'll find these in the camping section as well because they are sometimes used for camping. It is very thick foam. You'll see how thick that is. This is 5/8 of an inch thick. This is what Halo armorers use for their armor. Mass Effect as well. So if you need that real heavy, durable armor, Eva foam is a very good choice for it. Bear in mind, because it is thick, it is not as flexible as some of the other foams.
Oh, can I add something?
Yeah.
There is actually a variation of that. I'm not sure if it's the same molecular structure, but it's a lower density, therefore it's not as rigid, and it actually will,
pass this
it's
around.
That thick, it actually will do compound curves very easily, and they sell it at hardware stores generally as... Oh, what do they call it? What do they call it where it's like therapeutic for if you have to stand around for a while?
Yeah.
You know, they stress mats. Or like yeah. If you're a cashier in a retail outlet and then they have you standing in one place, it's extremely pliable. You can easily do compound curves with that. In fact, how many of you are familiar with sewing? Sewed costumes. Okay, so I have a lot more familiarity with, I started from the armor end and worked my way into sewing, so I was kind of shit out of luck. But if you're already familiar with sewing patterns, a lot of times, too, in order to fit flat pieces around a curved body, It will have you sew folds, darts, I guess you call them. Darts, is that my using the right word, right? Okay, basically you're folding the fabric in to decrease the fullness. The foam I'm talking about, which is different from that, the stress reducer or therapeutic foot massage foam, whatever it is, that stuff can, it actually will behave almost like kind of like a knit fabric. It's very thick. So you can't fold it in and sew a dart to reduce fullness, but you can. What's up?
This is a dart.
Okay, she's got a diagram. What you can
you
do
cut
with
out
this
a
stuff?
Piece of it.
You can cut out a pizza slice. You can pull these two edges together, and you can fishing line, or fish. I recommend fishing line because it's heavier duty. I guess you could do it with thread, but I wouldn't. You can actually sew this closed, and what that does is it creates a nice full area up here, like say in your torso. Right, if you're trying to do you're a big guy and you need some, you don't want it to look like boobs, but you know, a dart, and what that does is,
you put it together and then you get a
curved edge down here, which if you don't want, just like in a sewing pattern, you would cut your pattern differently, so instead of just going straight up into the triangle, it would kind of angle down, you know, to sort of counteract this curve, but think of it exactly like you would fabric. I don't know if anyone's ever thought of that before, but you obviously have to keep in mind, what is the fabric term? Ease?
Yes.
You need a lot more ease if you're cutting your pieces out of half inch thick or 5/8 inch thick foam. So obviously what I have done in the past is I took a simple vest pattern, I cut it out, I just guessed. I mean, she was saying don't guess, but I did, I'll admit it.
You can, it's just a
okay, and on your first project, you're gonna guess.
Yes.
This is my first, so I just went, okay, I'm gonna cut this pattern out two sizes too big if I was making it out of fabric, and cut it out of the foam instead, and it actually worked remarkably well. So that foam sample she's passing around now, that's the more rigid stuff, right?
Yep.
Okay, yeah, she's right, you're gonna have a hard time getting compound curves out of that, but I wish I had looked it up. The therapeutic stress relief foot massage foam is excellent. Okay, that's my bit.
No worries. I actually also have other samples of other foam.
Where can you purchase Eva foam?
You can purchase it at Lowe's, Home Depot, Harbor Freight, Walmart, Target, pretty much any retailer or hardware store. You just find them in different places. In retailers, you'll find them in fact, we're going to get to back to school here in a couple of months. You'll find them in back to school. You'll find them in camping in the off season, and then in hardware stores. Generally, you will find them, I guess you could call it the accessories area. You can always ask. They may also sell it along with the insulation foam, which is the pink stuff. Besides the foams, you can use cardboard, both corrugated and the stuff you find boxes. So if you work for an office company that gives you a whole bunch of free cardboard boxes, just tell them you're gonna recycle it. You're technically recycling it when you turn it into armor. You can use poster board, cardstock, which is very thick paper. It is used with pepacura. Does anybody not know what pepacura is? Okay. Pepacura is basically origami armor. It is taking a 3D shape, so if you have a scan from your favorite video game, you can import it into a special program that will break it down. It will take a 3D object, break it down into a 2D form. Basically, it will make it flat on paper, and then you can alter the shape just a little bit. It will let you place seams and move seams, and then you print it out on cardstock. It's just like you did in middle school. You cut it out, and you fold it, and you glue it together. That's all pepacura is. After that, a lot of people do use resin to make it hard, because cardstock does not make very durable armor by itself. But you can put something on the outside to make it hard. And actually, a lot of Halo and a lot of the 501st guys use pepacura. And they do other things on the outside. They do Bondo. They do what's called Rondo. Rondo is basically a mixture of resin and Bondo. Hence, Rondo. And basically, they use it like a shellac. They paint it on with a brush. It's like a gel coating. You can also slush it around. If you do these sorts of things, do them in a ventilated area, please. Resin smells to high heaven. Any kind of resin does have a smell. Some are less than others, but they all have smell. Yes?
Some of the fumes may also be toxic.
Indeed. Some of the fumes may be toxic.
That's debatable. You'll either hate it or you'll love it.
or you will love hate it. All right, so you've also got cloth, chain rings, which are chain mail, resin, and then of course you have your usual tools that you use after you've made your armor. Patterning, and you actually touched a little bit on this. You can either freehand, so you can guess. It's a little more helpful if you take your body measurements first, just so you have an idea of how much of a space you have to fit around. You can also use commercial patterns. They're starting to come out with armor patterns. Surprisingly enough, Simplicity and Butterick, thank you Lord of the Rings, have started coming out with armor patterns. Granted, you know, they're flimsy armor patterns, but you can actually improve upon them. They're a base to start off. But they do make them, and that makes me a very happy nerd. You can also use a little bit of math to approximate the size of the pieces, which basically just means taking your reference picture, measuring the length on the figure, and then doing a little proportional math on you. Which, yes, you do have to use math in cosplay, I'm very sorry. It is basic math, however, it's not calculus. Unless you really want to do calculus on compound curves, in which case I say more power to you. Whichever method you use, make sure that you are constantly checking the fit. Again, you don't want to do your final test fit at the con. So periodically, you know, hold it up to yourself. If you need to, you can masking tape it together. If you have side seams and whatnot, if you're doing fitting, you can tape it together just to make sure it fits, because you want it to come out with a proper fit in the end so that it's comfortable, durable, and somewhat flexible. As you are patterning, this is probably the hardest part of armor making. Consider how you're going to attach it to your body. In anime, clearly they never bathe. They never take their armor off. They never sleep. Because there are no seams on their armor. There are no clear attachment points for a lot of them. So you have to figure out, how the heck am I going to get this to stay on my body and still look correct? So you'll have a series of, you know, straps, magnets. You may use rivets. There are any number of things you can use to attach it, but you need to start considering that in the patterning process when you start designing it. You don't want to do it at the end because it will not work as well for you. It's a little harder to add things at the end. Then you become friends with hot glue and barge. All right, a little bit. We did go over Pepakura basically. If you don't have a prepped Pepakura pattern, which you can go online, there are Pepakura libraries. In fact, you can just Google Pepakura library. If you don't have a pre-prepped file, you will have to manually work it yourself. It's user intuitive, so you don't have to be a mad scientist to use the program. You can be if you want to. But it's pretty user friendly. Basically, you are literally dragging and dropping lines to make the seams, because you'll find that when you print out Pepakura patterns on the paper, when you fold them, it may not look quite the way it does in the video game that you rendered from. So you may need to move things around, do a couple of test prints, find out what works for you. If a PEP file does not exist for your armor, which PEP is short for Pepakura, that's how you'll see it online, you can create one with 3D software. There are ways to import from your favorite video games. If you don't find a PEP file for, say, Mass Effect, for a character that you don't have, you know, a library file for, you can either very nicely ask a friend to import it for you, or you can import it into a program like Blender, which Blender is free. It is not user intuitive. I'm very sorry. So you may have to ask someone to help you out importing it. And there are instructions on PEP's website for doing a lot of this. There are tutorials. It's meant to be used with cardstock. You can try it with craft foam. It does not work as well. It's meant to be used with paper because it is an origami-like skill. Types of armor, and hopefully you can help me out with some of these. You have soft armors, which are cloth, foam that is not coated, not shellacked, leather, and paper mache is actually considered soft because it is flexible. Hybrid armor, chainmail, because chainmail is both soft and hard and weighs a ton. Yes. But it looks cool, right? You guys have seen the Lynx walking around with the chainmail shirts. don't ask them how tired they are at the end of the day. And then you've got your hard armor, which are the less flexible varieties. You've got thermoplastics, resin-coated foam, resin cast armor. Yes, you can cast armor. And metal plating, which we will go over metal armor a little bit later. Oops. Some of those repeated themselves. I don't know why. Your armor vocabulary. If you want to go online to find armor patterns, you will probably want to know some of these. And in fact, there's this lovely site. Armor, which they spell it the old way. Armorarchive.org. If you want to know how to make any kind of armor, they have both a historical archive where you can read up about historical types of armor, and the best part, they have free downloadable patterns for all of them. Full size.
Where do you print out your full size patterns?
Sorry, what was that?
Where do you print out your full size patterns?
You can either take the files to a place like Kinko's FedEx and have them print it for you, or if you use a program like, website like Blockposter, you can feed them the file, they will break it down into sheets of paper for you, you print all the sheets together and tape them together. You can either go to Blockposter, I think it's .com, if I'm not mistaken, I think it's blockposter.com, or you can take it to FedEx Kinko's, and they can print it on their large-scale printers. But they're full-size. Bear in mind, they are sized for an average person, so you may need to change the sizing on it, because not everybody is the same. We're all unique special snowflakes. All right, so the headguard, the helm, so is called a helm or a coif. Coif is usually, I've seen, used with chainmail rather than the actual metal helm. A gorget is the neck guard. Very important back in the day. Spalders are what you call the bicep or upper arm guards, the ones that go up here. Pauldrons are the shoulders. That's what you normally see when people are wearing armor. You see the pauldrons. Vam braces, that is actually what you call lower arm guards. These are not gauntlets. Everybody calls them that, but they're actually called vam braces. Gauntlets are the glove. Gauntlets are the gloves. And then I'm not even sure how to pronounce that one. It looks like cuisses, but I can't promise that it's pronounced that way because a lot of these are French. They're the hip and thigh guards. They go down here. Sometimes you'll actually see them as plates on the side. Sometimes you'll see it as a full skirt, especially if it's chainmail. To see examples of a lot of these things, you can go to Armor Archive and they have pictures.
Can we call them cusses?
Sorry, what was that?
Can we call them cusses so that we can talk about our cussy?
If it floats your boat, I say more power to you. And then greaves are the calf guards, down there. Soft armor, and I know, have you started with soft armors? The cloth armors?
I avoid soft.
Okay, fair enough.
I can give you my opinion, but it's not going to be encouraging. Sorry.
Fair enough.
Oh, well, you know.
Cloth armors have a couple of advantages, mostly that they are cheap, quick, easily available. You can go to any fabric store and get fabric and make armor out of it. Usually, you'll end up, if you don't just sew it, if you need more structure, people will put craft foam inside it. It's also lightweight, and it can be easy to attach because you can literally stitch your attachments, your straps, and whatnot to it.
Hey, Amber?
Yeah.
Oh, take the question first.
Oh,
can I
yes.
Can I make a quick comment on that?
Yeah.
It's very annoying to work with.
Sorry, what was that?
Vinyl works, yes. But it's very annoying to work with.
Vinyl is very annoying to work with. I agree with that. Even there are different grades of vinyl. There are two-way stretch and four-way stretch vinyl. All of them are equally hard to work with. But they look really good if you can get it to work. Have any of you guys seen Saint Seiya armor? Okay, there's a couple hands. They use vinyl over foam for their armors. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was just thinking, I guess, since we just got through with the terminology, let me make sure this is correct first. I don't want to be showing a gauntlet since we're. Would this be considered a?
That is a vam brace.
Okay, so all right, then I have made soft armor.
Sweet.
And actually, incidentally, I didn't even think of this, but this is the foam I was talking about that you can actually do compound curves with, so we can
pass it around.
Let me make sure this is what I actually finished.
Some of you guys may recognize this, aren't you?
I've used it as that. It's also a koozie.
I love modular armor. All right, some of you guys may recognize this armor. This is Slayer's armor. These are pauldrons. These are soft, so these are nice and flexible. This is made of fabric over craft foam. All you literally do is you make a sandwich. Fabric on top, craft foam, fabric underneath. Sew it all together. You'll notice, you may be able to see this, I'm not sure about the lighting, but there is bunching on the bottom of my armor. You can see where the fabric is bunched. That is because when you curve fabric and or foam, the surface underneath is actually smaller than the surface on top. So your piece of fabric on bottom will have to be slightly smaller than the piece on top, because otherwise you get this effect, you get the bunching. And if I were to compete in the master's category, they would laugh at me. Because this shows amateurish work. This is actually one of my first pieces of armor.
That's actually also true with, it's another similarity between patterning and constructing armor and sewing. Because I've learned the hard way that if you've got to sew something and turn it so your raw edges are on the inside, I used to struggle with how do I get that seam to not show? And then finally someone enlightened me that I could cut the piece that's going to go on the bottom slightly smaller so that when I flip it, it forces the seam to the underside. It literally pulls, because literally when you sew the edges together, you're stretching the bottom to line up with the top piece. So it's counterintuitive, but there's actually so many similarities between constructing armor out of these various materials and just basically sewing clothes.
So if you have a curve, your upper piece may be 6 inches, but you'll find that your bottom piece has to be 5.5. So you may actually have to cut off just a little bit around all of the edges, by the way. It's equally curving. To be able to get it to fit smoothly, it's kind of similar to gathering and sewing, actually. And it can be a little bit of a pain to do cleanly.
If you know how to sew already, you have an advantage.
Yes.
Over me, certainly. I'm still learning how to sew.
Oh, I'm constantly learning still how to make armor.
Well, we should meet in the middle at some point.
Sweet. All right, and of course, disadvantages of soft armor: lack of durability, simply because fabric tends to have a little bit less durability than, say, the harder armors. It can be difficult to prevent paint from cracking. Has anybody painted fabric before? Couple people. I think some of you have seen that if you flex fabric, the paint will start to crack after a while. And so it's harder to get that really awesome looking armor paint job with fabric maintained. It'll crack over time. It's also difficult to repair invisibly. Have any of you guys ever had a costume spring a hole, a leak, tearing, any of that stuff? I see a few nods. Okay, it's like I know all of you have had a costume break. All of you had a costume break at some point. It's a little harder to repair it where you can't see it. You will see the seam where you fixed it. Masking tape, sadly, fixes many things. Duct tape fixes even more things. Super glue will fix the world, but not invisibly. You will see it. And then similar advantages and disadvantages to foam and cardboard and paper mache based armors. Which, if you guys have not seen this miraculous stuff, this is called fast mache. This is paper mache in a box. This is a powder form of paper mache. You literally mix it with water and you slop it on your arm. And then you sand it down and sand and sand and sand. And then you take a break and you sand some more. But I find this to be very useful stuff for base layers of armor, simply because it goes a lot more quickly. Instead of having to take all your paper strips, dip them in glue, and then put them all down, and then wait, and then do it again, I find this to be much faster. Not quite as durable, not quite as flexible, but definitely faster. So if you're in a hurry, pass mache is your friend. Also good for props. Yes? I actually bought this at Joann's. I've also seen it at Hobby Lobby. I'm pretty sure you could get it at Michael's as well. I don't go in Michael's very much.
Is there a reason for that?
Not going into Michael's?
Yeah.
Less selection. Uh-huh. And also because usually when I'm going into a store, I need fabric, and Michael's doesn't carry fabric. They match Joann's. You can take Joann's into a Michael's. You can actually now interchange. I think Hobby Lobby, Michael's, and Joann's all take each other's coupons now. So the yes, and Hancock. Oh, they don't? Okay. Okay. So Hobby Lobby is odd man out, and everybody else takes each other's coupons.
And if you have like any soft fabrics, they do the same thing.
Okay. Why don't they just all combine into like the biggest awesome craft store ever? Okay. All right. And do you have your soda tab shirt?
Oh, I didn't.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's fine.
I can talk about that.
Okay, because hybrid chainmail is our next section.
Is it? Okay.
Yep.
Yeah.
All right. So chainmail, guys.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Chainmail looks fantastic. Can protect against glomping. Your materials are easily available, easy to repair, and you don't need very much.
What the hell is glomping?
Tackle.
There's a word for that?
Yes.
It is con specific.
The true idea of a glomp can only be described in demonstration.
No. Here's the thing. I'm pretty sure it's already been demonstrated to me multiple times. I just didn't know it had a word.
Most times it's a salt.
Yes.
That's the word.
The nice people will ask you before they do it.
Well, and the hug thing. You know, just like, finally they can't beat them. Sure. When in Rome, I'd say.
All right, if you ever want to know how to do any kind of chainmail, go here. Because they also have tutorials. They have CGI tutorials, photo tutorials, and video tutorials on every single chainmail weave literally that exists. Even ones that people have developed themselves. So you can literally find elven weave from Lord of the Rings. You can find dragon mail weave. You can find Helm's weave. You can find pretty much anything on male artisan stuff. I use them myself, actually, when I make jewelry. Yes?
Where do you get your ring, male artisan?
The Ring Lord.
The Ring Lord, yes.
Yes.
Every
I don't think it is the Ring Lord.
One supplier to rule them all.
Yes. You made the joke before I could get to it.
Oh.
Yes.
You can also make it with
yes. Yes. And I do know people who take wire, usually about 16, 18 gauge wire, take a rod or a dowel, mount it on a drill, and then go
whee! That is so painful.
And then you take a Dremel or a power tool with a cutting wheel and you slice down the length of the rod, and then you get a pile of rings. So you can make your own custom-sized rings that way. You just have to buy your own wire. Yes?
I was going to say, the other thing that you can do as well, you know somebody that's a spring maker, you can use spring steel.
Yes, you can.
They will roll you very long. And
yes.
But it is tedious because you have to solder it.
Yes.
But it's very, very durable when you're done.
Yes, it is. And there are two types of rings. Incidentally, you have your open, or what they may call jump rings, and then you have your butted rings. That's not meant to sound dirty. It means the ends are butted up against each other, and then they weld it shut. So those rings cannot be opened. It's very, very durable, but you can't open the rings. So you have to put other rings through them that you can't open. So when you order from Ring Lord, they will ask if you want spring rings or if you want butted rings. And if you ever buy rings, they will sell them to you either by the ounce or by the pound, usually not by the number of rings you need. So you'll have to take an educated guess how many rings it takes to make whatever it is you're going to make. For a good-sized shirt, you are looking at 8,000 to 10,000 rings. It's a lot of rings.
Oh,
If you make scale mail, it's about the same thing. And Ringlord sells scales as well if you want to make dragon scale or scale mail. It looks really cool. I want one so much. You can also buy pre-made shirts. They'll just make them and sell them to you if you just need to buy a chainmail or scale mail shirt. Well, what?
You can use soda tops.
Yes, you can use soda tabs.
Does anyone have, I can make some real quick if anyone's got a can.
Monster cans, anybody?
Well, like I said, I forgot to bring my,
Those swatches.
But yeah, it's so easy. We can just make a swatch right here if I got enough.
Has anybody seen soda tab mail?
Yeah, I got a shirt.
Is there somebody who said they had one?
Okay, that's four.
Because yes, you can make chainmail out of soda tabs. It works about the same way as making it out of rings.
It's much, much lighter.
It is much lighter.
It's still heavy, but lighter.
Any other ones?
We're going to have a live demonstration of tab mail.
Do you have a cutter? A wire cutter?
I don't have a wire cutter, but I do have I guess I don't even have the attachments for the drill.
I guess I don't have a cutter like that.
Yeah, I need something to snip this.
I don't know that I have anything that strong.
Yeah, it's...
No, I don't.
No?
Oh, not
well.
With me.
Well, I am now coining a term for this stuff.
Oh.
I'm calling copyright. I have it on film. It's copyrighted. It is called tab mail. Copyright Amber. All right, disadvantages. Scale mail and chain mail are heavy. Shirts are about 15 pounds.
Yeah.
So if you want to know what that feels like, take a couple of weights, maybe about 5-7 pounds each, put one on each shoulder, and then walk around with them for 8 hours. See how you feel at the end of the day.
Mm. Oh, it's, you know what? I can add something. Since we're talking about the weight.
Yes, please.
Right. Here's another website that would be nice to know.
Go right ahead. That is what the whiteboard is for.
It's called ringmesh. I think it's .com probably. And what they are, stainless steel, the rings are actually, that they're smaller than your typical rings for weaving chainmail, and it's all machined. So if you want to kind of, I want to do it myself, but I don't want to sit there and string each and every ring together, they will actually sell you ring sheets as fabric. They used to, I don't know if they still do, but they used to have a remnants. They used to actually have a remnant section where you could go and pay. I mean, you're still going to pay. Maybe you'd pay $100 or so. But you'd get a various assortment of whatever. And it's already, rings are already woven together. And I have in the past ordered their remnant package and just taken fishing line and just, okay, what pieces do I have? Okay, I can string this together. And you don't have the bragging rights of being able to say that you did all your rings from scratch. But you can still say, well, I ordered the ring as kind of a fabric, and I pieced it together to be in my particular shape. So that's another one that's worthy of mention. And we were talking about the weight. A full shirt, I did a full tunic for my late costume out of just their remnant package. As opposed to, they will also sell you a complete tunic for over $200. You know, full length sleeves, everything. You can buy the remnant packet. I'm not saying this is years ago, so prices may have gone up, but I purchased the remnant packet, kind of just pieced it together. You know, most of it was hidden under the tunic, so I really just needed it to show here and here and here. And that weighs about 7 pounds, as opposed full on everything, as opposed to 25 if I had been making it out of the larger steel rings. So anyway, that's another one.
You can also now buy plastic rings. For those who have seen Lord of the Rings, all of their scale mail was made of plastic rings. No joke. It took them 8 months of non-stop chain mailing to make them. They weighed 5 pounds.
Oh my goodness.
Okay, I thought I saw a hand up.
Hey, all you knife-wielding cosplayers out there, does anyone have a real knife? Or a Swiss Army knife, multi-tool? Does it actually have a clipper on it? No. A clipper? Yeah, probably this. Yeah, it's just a knife. I may not be able to do this thing, but I need actual. That! Yes! Very helpful.
Awesome. You, you guys are so resourceful.
Yes.
This is another alternative to chainmail. This is athletic mesh. You can buy, this is the stuff football jerseys are made of. You can buy it at Joann's, and all I did is I literally spray painted it silver. And if you put this under a shirt, it does look, from maybe about 10 feet away, it looks like chainmail. This weighs like a pound. And you can see I didn't put it all the way around because I only had to have a show for
I've never seen that before. What is that?
Athletic mesh.
Oh, like, okay. Interesting.
It's all mesh. It's like, it's, you can probably buy laundry bags and it's the same stuff. But it's you know, pretty decent looking if you need a cheap alternative if you don't want to sit there and make all the chainmail yourself or sew the mesh together. And besides, I like sewing. So yes, you can make chainmail out of soda can tabs, which it looks like we are going to get a live demonstration.
Maybe. Yeah, we'll see.
Sometimes, also, you'll notice that sometimes you'll see mail spelled like mail, like postal service mail, or you may see it spelled with two L's and an E. That's mostly just to differentiate it from standard postal mail. I prefer the double L spelling myself. Scale mail is similar to chainmail, more protective, heavier, if it's possible to get heavier than chainmail, and a little bit more expensive. If you buy the scales, it is more expensive than buying the rings. And like I said, most people that I have talked to do get their supplies from the Ring Lord, simply because it is inexpensive. Hard armor, thermoplastics. How many people have heard of this wondrous material called Warbla? How many people would like to work with Warbla? Okay, quite a few more hands. There's also Wonderflex, ABS, which is another type of thin plastic. It's used for vacuum forming, so if you ever see stormtroopers, some of them use ABS. There's also HIPS, which is high impact polystyrene. Basically, it's harder form of styrene. And Celastic or Sintra. If you've ever tried to buy Sintra recently, they no longer sell it under the brand name Sintra. They sell it as Celastic. So if you see either one, they are interchangeable. And I actually do have a little bit, and I will pass these around. This is styrene. This is 0.02 mil. You'll notice it's thin and it sounds like poster board. This is used for vacuum forming. Anything this thin is used for vacuum forming. You can also use this for stormtrooper armor. This is the stuff you can mold to your body. This is Warbla. It's a little bit thicker, a little bit less flexible. Both are heat formable with my friend. This is my best friend. This is a heat gun. You use this to not light things on fire. If you get a heat gun, bear in mind that thermoplastics take different temperatures to form. Not all thermoplastics are built equally. If you try and heat styrene at 250 degrees, you will melt a hole in it. No, I don't speak from experience. Warbla takes a slightly higher forming temperature than styrene. Styrene is about 175 degrees Fahrenheit. Warbla is slightly higher at 200. If you get a heat gun, you will probably want to get one with an adjustable gauge on it. This is so you can set different temperatures to be able to use different thermoplastics. If you get the kind that only have two heat settings, you get low and high. Low is usually higher than you need for thermoplastics. It's usually somewhere between 300 and 500 degrees. You will light plastic on fire. So invest in a variable temperature heat gun. This was $40 off Loot. And this goes between, I believe, 150 and 1500 degrees Fahrenheit. They're also used for paint stripping. They have to go that high for paint. Like I said, I don't use it to light things on fire. Let me see if I can do this. Demonstration time! I need a socket.
Here.
Socket.
Yeah, we'll have to. Unfortunately, I'm not able to cut it.
All right.
That little, is that the cutter part? The part that's in the real.
It wound up just bending.
You know, it didn't actually cut through. It wound up just bending it. That's okay. I should have brought my swatches. I'm still smacking myself for that.
Normally, if you use these, please wear gloves. You will burn your hands. I know Kamui, for those of you who know who Kamui is, she does a lot of the World of Warcraft armoring, and she recently did a wizard Protoss. She does not use gloves. We asked her why in an interview, and she said, I just get used to it. So, and we do prefer safety, so do wear gloves, which I'm promptly not going to do in front of you when I demo this.
Do as I say.
Yes, do as I say, not as I do, which I did not bring my heating gloves. All right, so I have checked the temperature on my heat gun. This not necessarily because it does not release fumes like cutting it does. So I'm going to try and heat this. You should be able to see it become floppy. That is my goal. May take a minute because I don't want to roast it. On the underside, it is getting slightly shiny. That is when you know it is starting to heat up. And I'm starting to see a slight bubble form in the middle. Okay. Can you guys see it? See it? I can't walk this around very far, but you can see where it's starting to bend. If you get to the point where it warps and it starts to bubble, you've gone too far. That's how you know. I did this on purpose to show you. That's how you know you've gone too far. If it starts to bubble like that. You want to get just before that point, that is when you form it. If you want to cool it down quickly after you have formed it, you can spray it with water. And that will cool it down very, very rapidly. And you can tell it's already cool to the touch.
Like in a mister bottle or something?
Yeah, yeah, squirt bottle. That's what I use. I heat it, I form it, I squirt it. It gets very wet. Yes? Please do not heat form to yourself. Please do not heat form to yourself. Please don't do it that way. It does burn. No. What you would need to do is you would need to make a duct tape double of whatever it is that you are going to form against. You will need a friend to help cut you out that you trust.
Because clear tape sculptures that you often find.
Yes.
That's really easy to do.
Also
yes.
I do it in a cold room when I did, I nearly passed out from heat exhaustion. So.
Yes. And a quick word about duct tape dummies. You can use plastic wrap, you can use cellophane, you can use duct tape, you can use clear packing tape. You can use any number of things. Use it on a shirt that you do not mind losing because you will lose that shirt. And please do not do it on your bare skin. Wear a shirt. It hurts to take it off.
Marco, do you want to, you don't do it on your bare skin, but you do like the spray wrap and then the tape?
Yes. Just not don't tape on your bare skin. It's very hard to get it off that way. And then once you have had a friend tape you around, and there are tutorials online for this. In fact, we have one on our podcast for my podcast buddy. I let her wrap me in duct tape and cut me out. Just make sure that you trust them with scissors because they are going to be cutting up on your back. And make sure, ladies, pull your hair up because otherwise you will end up with a very ragged haircut. When you make duct tape forms of other body parts, it is done the exact same way. You can make them of your forearms if you're making gauntlets, biceps if you're making spalders. You may, in fact, want to have an entire lower body duct tape dummy just to be able to work on pants, the hip armor, greaves, any of that. It's really helpful to have a duct tape dummy. Stuff it. When you cut it off, you need to stuff it so it is hard. That is because if you're going to heat form on it, you're going to be putting weight on it. Otherwise, you're going to compress your duct tape dummy, and you're going to get a very small-sized piece of armor. You will get hobbit-sized armor. No offense. She cosplays as a hobbit, so. Yeah, you will get very small armor if you compress too hard, and then it doesn't fit you, because that's the whole point of making the duct tape dummy, right? You want it to fit you. That's how you would fit it to yourself.
What do you stuff yours with?
I stuffed mine with newspaper because it was free and plentiful. You can also use traditional stuffing. You can also use expanding foam. Please be careful with expanding foam because it expands very quickly and you will bust open your duct tape form.
Oh my God, and it's so annoying to get off your hands.
and carpet. Yes. Yes, you can. You can actually resin the outside of your duct tape dummy. The only downside to that is that you can no longer press pins into it at that point. If you have a duct tape dummy, you can pin things to it. If you resin it, you can't. Your pin will break. But yes, and actually, I'm going to fiberglass my duct tape dummy myself. So, I think I'm done changing shape. I'm getting to that age where I don't change shape anymore.
Wait till you're 50.
Okay. All right, so with your thermoplastics, they look great. They are durable for the most part, easy to repair, because there are wonderful things called friendly plastic and Bondo. Friendly plastic is just a low heat forming thermoplastic that comes in pellet form. They look a little bit like Fruity Pebbles. And you stick them in a boiling pot and they turn into this giant gelatinous mess, and then you get to pretend to be a mad scientist for a little while, and you pick it up and you use it almost like a putty. In fact, Bondo is an automotive putty. It's a little bit more toxic than friendly plastic. But then again, when you're making armor, what isn't toxic at some point? Yes?
Thermoplastics, since we're in Texas, mm-hmm. How does that mix with the summer?
Not well. Yes, I would highly recommend keeping it in the air conditioner. Thermoplastics themselves will deform. If you resin it, it does not. Yeah. Simply because resin has a chemical reaction to where once it sets, that's it. You can't reheat it and reform it. It's set.
I think for the sake of terminology, let's differentiate between thermoplastic sheets mm-hmm. And thermoplastic resins.
Yes.
It's thermoplastic resins, the what they mean by that is the heat activation process is one time. With thermoplastic sheeting, she's right, you can heat deform those. You can continuously reform those plastic sheets.
I can reheat this, and yeah. I can reform it.
I mean, she could literally shape that into one something and then heat it again and shape it into something else.
Yep.
Thermoplastic...
No. I have tried. If there is a way, please let me know, because I'm genuinely interested in learning how to fix this, because I have it. Fix the bubble.
Oh yeah, you're not gonna be able to.
Styrene, basically, once it's deformed.
Yeah, I mean, the most you're gonna be able to do is you could reshape the curve, but once you've got that, because literally what you're doing, when you're adding heat to this, you're creating the ability for the material to actually stretch. And like most materials, with even fabrics, once they stretch to a point, they're not going to stretch back. I mean, you know, they're not going to collapse back in on themselves because you've actually stretched the fibers of the material. It's kind of like it only has so much ability to return. Now, so to differentiate, thermoplastic sheeting is going to have that property where you can reshape, which could be good, but the downside of that is you leave it in your hot car, suddenly your armor's in a completely different shape. Now, thermoplastic resins are single, I mean, they're the heat generated by that chemical reaction is the heat is used to cure the materials, but once they're cured, they are cured. You are not going to be able to reshape that. Actually, I've heard that you can to some extent.
I have not found the way yet.
Okay, I know you were trying.
I've been trying.
But
for the sake of science.
But I can promise you that I have left armor in the hot car in July down in San Antonio at San Japan. And I picked it up and nearly scalded my hand. I'm like, oh shit, I should have left this in the car. I picked it up, I thought, okay. But no, it does not return to a pliable state. So if you don't want to have to worry about having
deformed
armor, utilize the thermoplastic resins. And I can actually talk about the. I don't know too much. I haven't used the sheeting that much, but the resins I'm all about. I'm
See,
all about
I've
the.
Used the sheeting
I'm all
a lot.
About the vapors, the fumes.
What's an example of thermoplastic resins?
That I brought.
You have one because I have fiberglass resin, but that's it.
Okay.
I have polyester resin too.
I got the materials and the finish. Well,
okay.
I didn't paint.
We've read all sorts of chemically things.
Yeah. So the idea of thermoplastic resins is that typically what you're doing is you're going to work with fiberglass or some other cloth, fibrous, porous material to act as a laminate. Yeah, that, now there are, when I use the term fiberglass,
There are actually two components to that. Fiberglass is what they call a composite, so it literally is, a lot of people just say fiberglass. That is not fiberglass, that is fiberglass resin, commonly used in conjunction with fiberglass. You do not have to use it with fiberglass.
That's correct. Polyester resin.
Yes, that's, now, but a lot of times what they do is they'll sell it, I think 3M actually sells it as polyester resin. Bondo, I think, sells it at, is that Bondo or 3M?
This is Bondo.
Okay, Bondo will sell it as fiberglass resin because the most common application is with fiberglass.
Correct.
I actually brought an example of the polyester resin or fiberglass resin, but I didn't want to use fiberglass. I thought, you know, fiberglass is kind of nasty stuff. You start sanding it and cutting it, you get those little scratchy particles in the air, and it gets on your skin and you don't realize that you lay down in the bed at night, you're like, oh God, what is this? I mean, it's terrible. When I've used fiberglass and sanded the stuff down, I had to literally take duct tape and put it all along my arm and pull it off in order to remove the tiny, the microscopic glass particles. Because fiberglass is glass. It is a finely woven glass cloth. And it's extremely useful for repairs. It's very durable. It's a very common home do-it-yourself bathtub repair, boating repair, but cosplayers, I've noticed, seem to think everything that looks cool is fiberglass. It's not true. You don't have to use it, and a lot of times it's kind of overkill. It's really more durable than what you'd actually need in cosplay. Fiberglass is applied as a laminate, and that just basically means, you know, you have that piece of foam that's going around somewhere, the EVA foam. That just means you let's say you've created your what the hell, Vambrace?
Yeah.
You've created your Vambrace out of that, and now you want to add a hard, paintable surface. So you would do a laminate on top of that, which would be your fiberglass plus your polyester resin. Now you can just do polyester resin without fiberglass, but that's brittle. If for some reason your piece, like that arm guard I passed around, now that, when I pull that off my arm, that's actually got to be able to stretch open a little bit so I get my hand out of that. That would not be good if I were to reinforce that with resin alone, because it's brittle, it's not flexible. The composite material, and when I say composite, that means I'm combining more than one material in order to increase the benefits and decrease the disadvantages of both materials used separately. That was a long sentence. But if I do a laminate on that, a fiberglass laminate, which I'm not because it's leather covered instead. If I did a fiberglass laminate on this area where it actually has to sort of flex open a little bit, I would actually get a little bit of pliability there, because the fiberglass is going to decrease the brittleness of the resin alone. And I'm talking 100 miles an hour. Does anybody have any questions? Did I just like sort of leave everybody in the okay. Okay, so what we're doing when we actually layer on top is we're actually applying a laminate, and that's what fiberglass typically is, and normally you're going to use a combination of the polyester resin and the fiberglass cloth. I don't know if you have a sample of that. That stuff's really nasty. Let's just try to avoid it if we can.
I brought the interfacing.
Oh, you did? Oh, that's the really... Oh, I've never tried to use that kind.
I've used it twice.
Huh.
If you use fiberglass resin, usually what you think of is using fiberglass resin and fiberglass mat or cloth. It's basically fabric with fiberglass pieces woven into it. And when you combine the two, you get a chemical reaction that makes it stronger. And it sets. And if you use that stuff and you get it in your carpet or in your curtains, you cannot get it out. I have some stuck in my curtains right now, actually. I have fiberglass curtains, and that was not intentional. That was because a prop touched it, and, well, that's what happened. Actually, I do not use fiberglass cloth with my resin. I use interfacing. Sewers are probably real familiar with this stuff.
Yeah, the whole concept of a composite is literally, my resin alone is going to be brittle and subject to stress cracking. Adding an absorbent fiber, some sort of material that can take in the resin and sort of mix with it. Mm-hmm. It needs to be porous. That's what I'm saying. You don't add resin on top of foam and expect there to be an actual mixing of the two layers. They remain separate layers. They do not reinforce each other. A cloth I mean, a polyester cloth, a cotton cloth, glass cloth, any sort of porous material, absorbent. Absorbent material is going to take in that resin, and the resulting composite is going to be stronger than either material would be used alone.
I've used newspaper.
Is there a particular greater thickness of that cloth than you recommended?
Various thicknesses. This is a very thin, this would have drape. So you could drape this over curves, compound curves. The stuff I was going to pass around is a heavier weight interface. Now, if you don't have a base object, like you would drape this around some sort of object that you've already patterned. But if you are trying to create a thinner piece, and literally all you want to do is, yeah, go ahead and pass those around. Literally all you want to do is create, sort of skip a step, so to speak. Patterning out of the same material that you're going to resin, you could use a thicker interfacing. In fact, the one I'm passing around now, this is actually, I want to say it's a 72, I guess that's the weight. It's 72F, I think the F just means fusible. Doesn't matter if there's, is that what that F means?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Just
okay, yeah, there's a very, very heavy weight. It's a polyester fiber. It's sold in fabric stores. 72F, I think, is the weight in the description. And literally, you know, it just takes scissors to cut it. But once you add your resin layer in, because the fiber is porous, I mean, it absorbs in, and you can see I only applied resin to one side, but it soaks into the fiber, and so really the whole thing is just a solid piece of plastic at this point. It started out as something kind of like this that I was just able to cut with scissors.
Yep. Question back there?
Okay, so interfacing works well, and all that you need is a porous kind of fabric to soak it up.
Yes.
What about felt?
Yes. In fact, before, because I wasn't a sewer, I called this felt for the longest time. I was like, felt. And everyone's like, you mean the stuff you... No, not that stuff. The heavier stuff, they're like, that's interfacing. It's stiffer. I mean, you can use felt.
You can use felt, you can use cloth, you can use cotton, you can use muslin, you can use any porous cloth.
In making that, I'm assuming that you cut out the pattern and then you drape it over a soft curve and painted it with resin. How do you make that curve?
Okay, that's a good point, because what's going to happen, once you saturate this with resin, this was firm, this was nice and solid, and it was the very heavyweight interfacing at first. Once you saturate it with resin and you add that weight, it's going to turn all floppy. And then you're going to have to cure it in the right shape. So you really have to plan your support structures before you start your resin. Now, what I did is, because I thought about all this, I was like, okay, I gotta make sure this cures into the nice, gentle curve here. I think I took a rod and I punched holes here and here, and I put a piece of fishing line across and I kind of just hung it. And let just gravity do the work. And then I painted it on, I put it on my little thing, and I just walked away from it, and you know, it cures really fast. So, but yeah, you don't wanna resin your piece and then think, well, where do I set it down? You wanna have some sort of support structure planned out so that after you do your resin application, you can immediately place it wherever it needs to go to cure in the right shape.
I bent mine first. All my pieces, I bend them first so that they're in that shape, then I fiberglass it in that shape. So you bend the structure first, then you fiberglass it.
But let's make sure they understand there's a difference between having the support structure already there separate and having your piece be your final structure.
Right. I was speaking about the latter.
Yeah.
Speaking about structure first. I think in the back you had a question.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
I was just wondering, like, for the support structure, can you create, like, some sort of, like, substance or something, like, vaseline or something like that, to keep the resin from sticking to it as well?
A release.
So you're going to use, like, a cereal bulb to, like, create that.
Oh, yeah. So what can I lay down on that it's not actually going to stick to?
Yeah.
Okay. What I do a lot of times is I'll actually cover whatever my support structure is. Don't do this, but I have actually covered myself. I think I made a chest plate at one point, and I kind of put a taped piece of aluminum foil to my chest and thought, I want this to cure in the shape of my chest. I
put a, you know, facing of aluminum foil. I did my resin on my chest piece, and I laid down on a bed and went, okay, just a layer of about 15 minutes.
Takes about 15 minutes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh,
while it gives off heat. This is why I do as we say, not
okay,
as we do.
My incident with the foil, that was after I learned a few things, so that was actually not so bad. I actually have another story. The very first time, I had the idea that the ideal support structure is your actual body. When you produce a duct tape double, you're going to introduce minor inconsistencies, and not only that, but it's time. I just figured, well, I'm just going to save myself that time. I'm just going to... So I had the vest pattern. I think I've told you all this already. I did a pattern out of a vest. I fishing line hand sewed it together, put it over. I basically constructed what I would call a life vest. That's what it looked like. And I got my two brothers-in-law on one hot July evening and said, well, we're just going to stand out on the street corner.
It's a life vest.
And you guys are going to, something kind of like that. Well, only it was made out of that foam that I passed around earlier. I had that thing on, and I said, you guys are just going to fiberglass me right here. I want you to laminate on top of what I'm wearing.
Laminate me!
which was interesting, because we were standing outside the my parents' house, and people were driving by, and they were making jokes, because they were kind of having to work the resin into the fiber. It's like paper mache. So if you've ever done paper mache, and you put the strips, and then you paint the glue on, and you kind of just let it soak in, well... fiberglass takes a little pressing, kneading to sort of work it into the fiber. So I'm standing out here like this, wearing this vest, and they're just like, oh yeah. Yes. And we just decided to make a big joke out of it. Well, from time to time, they'd get a little too much resin.
Personal.
Well, okay, that, of course. But from time to time, they'd have an occasional drip. And I wouldn't notice when it would hit my legs. I was wearing shorts. I wouldn't notice, but I'd get a drip down my leg, and then I'd just be standing there, and all of a sudden it'd start to cure, and I'd go, oh, it's burning! It's burning! Get it off! It's right there! It's right there! I couldn't bend down, so... Yeah, so...
You had your hands like this?
I think I started like this, but then we realized it was pulling up, and when the resin cured, it was going to cure in an improper form, so I tried to stand a little more natural.
So you're trying to go...
Yeah, I had my arms up because to get out, to be out of the way, and I'm like, it dripped, get it, wipe it off. So that's really what not to do, but yes, your own body is what you're going for, and in those few moments you have before the resin cures, you need to try to get your floppy piece to sort of drape in the right shape to lay flush against your body, and that's a challenge. I don't recommend doing what I've done, although I will say it worked. It did work. But if I had known to do the duct tape dummy or have some sort of alternate body form, I would have done that in a heartbeat. I just didn't want to spend the time, and I figured, well, this will work, so I'll do it. But most simple shapes, like just the van braces and, you know, even the shoulder pauldrons. What is that? Which one did I pass around this one?
No, there's one going. Oh.
I've only passed around one, but it was this
one. The other
one's right.
Started the bed, if you want.
Okay. This was like for Twilight Princess Zelda. This is just a shoulder piece. I mean, it's not a complex curve. It's only curving on one axis. So literally, you can just do this. You know, I hung the piece while it cured. A chest piece. That's a little more challenging, and you're going to have to build some kind of structure that imitates. The form, the shape of your chest, and her idea of the duct tape double is probably a much better idea.
We can wear like a hat.
I'm sorry.
If you're going to wear armor for any length of time, leave room for some padding.
Yeah.
Which we are, padding is one of my
slides. Yeah, now I think I did mine out of this same stuff, this real soft. So I didn't do any padding because I only laminated on the outside. I didn't reinforce the inside, it wasn't necessary. So that was actually kind of comfortable, to be honest. Your question?
Actually, it's more. Women, wear your undergarments under your armor when you're making your
duct tape dummy, wear your undergarments that you intend to wear at the con or whatever you're going to bake. And if you don't, you won't be in the same shape that you're going to bake. Just
there's a couple of different. I saw you first.
I just have a safety notation. You talked about the heat. The two-part epoxy, do not use extra hardener, because if you mix it too much harder, it will catch
fire.
And it makes a big, nasty, smoky mess.
Well, now, does epoxy actually cure with heat as well? I thought it was a lower temperature.
Your resins, when you're mixing your resins, you want hardener.
Yeah.
And you have the resin. If you mix too much hardener, it will literally catch fire.
Yeah, okay, well, I've never gone that far.
Follow instructions.
Yeah, absolutely.
On the containers, they actually tell you how much of this stuff, this is hardener, how much of this to put in your resin. The more you put in, the faster it cures, the hotter it cures, the more chance you have for fire. In that order.
Also,
so don't overdo
if you're,
it.
If you're trying, like I was, to take advantage of the fact that it's July and it's already hot.
Hot outside.
You can lay fiberglass very fast.
You will be
in fact, sometimes too fast, you will actually not be able to. You got to mix your resin in small batches. Heat, the ambient heat makes a difference. If you've stored your resin in a hot garage, it's already hot when you get it out to start, so you have very little pot life, very little working time, which if you're like I was and you wanted your con was in a few days, that's fine. That's great. We went outside for that reason. We weren't worried about fumes. We didn't go outside for that reason. We like the fumes. We went outside because we wanted it to be hot.
This is pot as in container, not pot.
Pot life. I'm sorry.
Pot life and fumes together, and I'm like, wait a second.
Okay. I use industry jargon, and sometimes I realize it sounds like something else.
Also, quick tip, if you want to use your brushes over and over again, use silicone basting brushes, then you just break the resin off.
Yeah,
and you can
actually,
reuse them without
actually
cleaning.
Does work.
Yeah, I have several friends who just get a silicone basting brush, nothing sticks to silicone, including resin, so when you're done, you just break off the resin and it's clean.
Mm-hmm. I actually,
you can get them at the dollar store.
That actually, I actually wasn't sure that would work, but I tried it like a couple nights ago.
And I was like, dude, yeah. Why have I not been doing this before? Because otherwise you have to use acetone to clean your brushes.
Or just chunk them.
Yeah,
or
just dispose
have to chunk them if you don't.
Yep.
Actually, I got these other two pieces I was going to pass around because before we get to metal.
Oh, I'm just prepping for the next one.
Oh, okay.
One, so keep going.
So as we already covered the fact that fiberglass is to be avoided if you can. It's really not necessary. Everyone calls it fiberglass resin, but you don't have to. All you're trying to do is create a laminate. A composite material with your resin as the brittle, hard, hardening substance and the fiber, the absorbent fiber, as your what adds flexibility. So you can do that with a variety of different materials. You can also get creative and browse the hardware store looking for, or hell, browse fabric stores, browse Bed Bath & Beyond, browse any store that might offer you some sort of preformed geometry that you can utilize so you don't actually have to do patterning. Complex curves. I wanted a pauldron. Okay. I wanted a sort of a rounded piece to go over my shoulder, and this lays on top of it as the. Does it look like Twilight Princess Zelda? Because that's what I was going for. Okay. So, you know, this curve. I thought this is going to be a nasty curve. It's a compound curve, so you know it's curving on more than one axis. Yeah, I don't know if I'm gonna pass that around too.
Brief point.
The things you learn.
Yeah.
Shh. Guys. Question.
Oh, that's.
Shh, guys, I can't hear it.
Yes.
You would probably have to find an approximate shape, like a small bowl or even part of a globe to form over, because you do not want to make a duct tape form of your face, and you definitely don't want a fiberglass on your face. So find something close. In fact, If you find a full face mask that fits you, you may be able to simply use that as a form and form over it, just part of it. And that way, you know, you have a structure there to fiberglass over, which makes it nice and comfy, and comfort is a very good thing in cosplay. Guys, give me just a second. I know there are other questions, but there's talking everywhere and I can't hear.
There is a way to actually make the duct tape mask for your face, but mm-hmm. with clear tape, they use a paragon tube for a breath hole, and then you tape around it, and then when you cut your head out kind of thing, you just tape it all back up together.
Did they use to cover your hair and your head?
You put it up in like a little cap kind of thing.
Okay. So
probably more for you.
Okay. I'm sure there are probably ways.
We did it for a summer project at my old high school. We actually did the Scotch cape sculptures, and so we did a full block of things.
Okay.
Just the nuggets, like the sock on the head. Not like the sock, but like the kind of thing.
Okay.
To hold the hair in. That's good.
Okay. Thank you. I saw a question over here on the side. Yes. Okay. Yes.
So I'm not sure if you answered it or not, but I asked about using Vaseline on a mold or something.
Oh.
A releasing agent.
Okay. Yeah, I think I got into those stories. I've never actually had luck using, I don't know that Vaseline or anything like that would work. Maybe she knows something. I've covered everything with aluminum foil or wax paper. Because actually, it will stick, but you can easily peel that off. But I don't know about an actual, unless she's got a trick.
My experience with Vaseline is that it does not work terribly well as a release agent for that. It works for mold casting, but it does not work very well for resin casting. Not for fiberglassing and whatnot. Unless, of course, I'm doing it wrong, which is entirely possible. I am not perfect by any stretch of the imagination. I saw other... Yes?
To answer a question, paste wax.
Paste wax.
Johnson's paste wax, min wax. You can brush it on.
Yeah, that would probably work because it's got it's waxed.
Right.
And wax paper, I've used wax paper, so you're
yeah.
probably right about
yeah,
that.
Yeah, the paste wax is basically a wax mixed with kerosene, so you can brush it on, smooth it out, and then it dries. The resin should release from that easily.
Question.
What I use for a mold release, using thorns, diamond-shaped oil,
right.
is clay pieces and water and K-line jelly.
Okay.
And that works really well.
Wait, were you Thorin yesterday?
No.
Oh. I was going to say, I was Bilbo. I kept looking for Thorin. I wanted to give him a big hug.
A hug.
That would have been a good picture.
One other mold release that you can use is the spray-on foam tire shine. Nothing.
Okay.
You spray that, nothing sticks to it. You have to use like lacquer thinner to get paint to stick.
I'm so glad this is recorded, because you guys are giving me ideas. There will be a trip to the hardware store next
week. Did you say this is being recorded?
Yeah. For my own edification. There are magical things that can be done in editing. Alright, metal plating, just don't. That's the long and short of metal plating at conventions. It's the heaviest possible thing you can wear. You have to maintain it. It's difficult to transport. If you leave it in a hot car, you will not be able to pick it up unless you have gloves. So it's just easier to leave it at home. I'm not saying you can't have it. You can have it. I feel like I'm mothering. You can have it.
Be careful.
But well, be careful with it, but it's better not to bring it to a con because it tends to reduce enjoyment just a little bit. It's expensive, heavy. You have to have special tools to work with it if you're going to make it, including a forge, which there are instructions online to build them. They need maintenance, difficult to transport and store, and some cons just don't even allow metal plating anymore. You can take it to Ren Fairs, though. I highly encourage that. Yes?
I work with metal, oriented, and yeah, I'll just say that, like, metal just, as far as I know, as far as I've experimented, it doesn't belong
to. Is what?
As far as I've worked on it, as far as I've experimented on it, it doesn't belong to my top.
Yes, that is a good way of putting it, the long and short of it. It does not belong at a con. If you have metal armor, wear it to a renter. Yes, Scarborough just ended. Gambesons and padding, which gambeson is just a name of a particular type of padding. You can basically use any sort of padded material, quilting. In fact, you can use old quilts from the dollar store and cut them into a shirt shape and wear them underneath as padding for your armor.
And they're cheap.
They are cheap, yes. And the point of it is to prevent chafing, especially if you are in chainmail, because for those who have never worn chainmail, it chafes. And it gives your armor a little better structure to sit on so that all the weight isn't on you. You'll be less tired at the end of the day, just slightly. Yes?
Is there anything you use for padding that is not going to give a heat stroke in the Texas summer? I mean, this year.
Yes.
Ice.
That was actually where I was going with this. Thank you for being a wonderful segue. Inside your padding, you can build a cooling vest. Which I am a motorcyclist, I know what it's like to be outside in 110 degrees with no air conditioning every day. So, this particular vest has pockets where I can put ice. There are four pockets for ice packs. Alternatively, what you can do, and this is what I'm going to do for next year, you may share my idea, but I am calling patent on it. When you have your vest, take some aquarium tubing, sew it inside the vest in a zigzag pattern throughout. Leave the two ends coming out in the bottom. You can either do it front or back, does not matter. You will have one end for the pump, mm-hmm. and a little aquarium pump, and you will have one end for the outflow, and then just have somebody carry around a small little container of ice water. Whenever you need a break, attach it to the pump, put the outtake in the container, and just cool off. Whenever you're ready, empty out ice container, fill it up with ice water again, take another break.
Where's cool suits that we use for racing?
Yes, there are cool suits.
So you can use those too.
Yes, and you can go to athletic stores. A lot of them do sell what are called sweat wicking shirts that help to wick away the sweat so that you cool off faster. It doesn't necessarily keep you ice cold, but it does help prevent heat stroke, which is a very important thing when wearing armor. Heat stroke is not pretty. I thought I saw a hand. Yes.
Could you use a light beam safe mode you used for water going up PC?
Yes, as long as you are careful not to break them. Self-contained, so you wouldn't want to get it everywhere. But yes, you can use cooling computer components, say that three times fast, to put inside your vest to keep cool. In fact, that's actually a really good idea. Thank you for the idea, I'm going to borrow it. I will give it back when it's done. I'm not stealing, I'll give it back to him when he's done. You can also use phase change vests. Those are a little bit harder to use to stay cool. They are better if you are making short trips with your armor, which is only a couple of hours. You dip the entire vest in ice water, and then you put it on and freeze for a couple of seconds, and then, feels much better. That's what a phase change vest is. A lot of motorcyclists use phase change vests. And you can use sweat wicking shirts. You can find them both at athletic stores and in diving stores. Which there are a few in Dallas. Adding details to armor, and I think you've definitely got experience with that.
Not with craft, though.
No, but that's one of the things you can use to add.
Gotcha.
These are different materials you can use to add details to your armor. Because you don't want flat armor, right?
Right.
You anime armor is not flat. It has elaborate details, shiny, sparkling, glowing madness. Yes, madness. Liquid madness. And so you can use different materials to add details. Craft foam is one that I used on here, and you can see the small arrows at the bottom and the lining. This is all craft foam. Very easy to cut. You just cut it to shape and glue it down. You can use paper clay or air dry clay. If you use air dry clay, I do make one caution, and that's that it does crack if you don't keep it moist as it is drying. But you can use it. I'm not saying don't use it, I'm just saying beware. Paper clay is basically clay mixed with?
Paper!
Thank you for those who answered. It's a little more fibrous clay. It works just like a putty, like standard clay. You still oven dry it. Note, if you're going to oven dry your clay, please clean it out when you're done so your food does not smell like whatever it is you just baked. You can use Wonderflex styrene and Warbla. That seems to be the new thing now, to where you can take these small pieces, like so, and you can cut elaborate shapes into them with X-Acto knives or with standard scissors if you have really good scissors. And then you literally just glue it down. Yes?
Can you put fiberglass on the Warbla?
You can put fiberglass on
it. You can put fiberglass on anything.
That's what I was figuring, but I mean as a make it all permanent.
However, the thing about that, and I'm not sure if you've done this or not, is that when you put a heat-activated chemical on a heat-activated plastic, it may change shape. Mm-hmm. Because you are heat-forming it with involuntary heat.
Yeah.
Yeah, anywhere you put fiberglass is going to get
warm. Going to heat up.
Yeah.
Yeah, so
but
if
I mean
you,
for like your details, like on your...
If you have that strong structure she was talking about that you're forming over,
yeah,
then it won't deform as easily, and then you could potentially do it.
Okay.
You just want to make sure it's not your shape's not going to deform as it's setting with the thermoset resin. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I mean, like for the details, like on her groove.
Right. Right.
Well, this is leather strips I just glued on.
And
if you're actually trying to build up additional geometry, I wouldn't call this. I mean, yeah, technically I'm building additional geometry here, but this. I mean, all I needed was thin pieces. If I needed to actually build up. Like if I had a breastplate, and all I did was just I basically have like a fiberglass vest, but then let's say I want to add like the Iron Man symbol, and I need to build up an area around here and put a light in there and do all that. I mean, that you could it is adding detail, but it's not fine detail. I wouldn't attempt fine detail with fiberglass. It's just. It would be good if you just want to build up thickness in a particular area because you need like more volume in the chest, let's say. If you wanted to actually build up pecs, like the armor that makes you look more muscular than you really are, you could do it with that because you'd just be adding gross amounts of thickness, not fine details. Yeah. So yeah, fiberglass really isn't good for the fine finishes. But building basic geometry, yes.
Building the base, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. In fact, what you can do if you want to add to a particular area, you want to just build it up so that it's raised from like say you want a change in elevation. You want one elevation here, and then you want more elevation here. Like I'm flat. I don't have much volume up there. So if I wanted to look real muscular, rather than just follow my body, I would actually want to have a thicker layer up here. So in that case. That's very simple geometry. I could literally just build up the thickness, but that would get heavy. I could also create another structure, on top of, say, maybe the stiffer interfacing. I could build that up. I could leave it hollow, so I'm not actually adding weight. And then I could fiberglass the outside. I keep saying fiberglass because I'm doing it too. I could apply polyester resin to the outside of that and harden it up. But I literally have a hollow space here, so I didn't add much weight. Does that all make sense?
Yeah.
I have two awesome new materials that I found in the store the other day. You find really weird things walking through the hardware store.
Is that the... I think I know what that is. Okay. Yeah, I've never had this.
This is plastic metal, which may seem like an oxymoron. It's basically... I don't want to say it's an epoxy, but it's similar to an epoxy in a tube that you literally push out. And it's actually kind of hard to push out. It's a gray, and it claims. Oh my gosh, the smell!
Oh,
yeah.
It does have.
The view girl.
No, really, I just want to actually see if I've used.
No, basically, it is a. It is a material that is. It's supposed to harden like metal. When you
know
are done.
What? That is like an epoxy. They also sell it as the stick where the two parts are already together and you just knead it.
Yes.
Automotive.
This is meant for automotive repairs, but of course anything that can be used for automotive can be used for cosplay. And so you can use this to add details to your armor as well. You can also use it to reinforce joints. The other thing I have found is plastic in a stick, because everything's better on a stick. This is called Mod Melts, and it is by the same people who make Friendly Mod Podge. They are literally glue sticks of friendly plastic. You put this in a hot glue gun, you squirt it out, it dries. And in 4 minutes, you get plastic. So you can literally use a glue gun and draw all your designs, wait 4 minutes. Hey, it's nice and hard now. You can cast gems with this.
Is it sandable though?
Is it sand?
Like if you,
I have tried it.
If you're not terribly neat when you do this, when you put it on and you get like a lump or something.
I have tried sanding it. I have not had much success.
I don't think it would be sandable.
It is heat formable again. So if you end up getting a shape you don't like, you can literally take heat to it. Like if you have a hot wire cutter from Styrofoam, you can reshape it. And it does reshape. Sandable, not so much. Reformable, yes. And yes, you can cast gems with this. That is specifically what it is for. It is for casting small ornaments. They sell silicone molds for this.
Can you use your same hot glue gun?
Yes.
For the regular?
Yes. Yes, it is meant for that. These, in fact, are mini size. So these are for mini glue guns.
Did you do that exclusively on the internet? Or do you
know no, these are exclusively at Michael's.
Now, is it clear when it dries?
These particular ones are clear. They sell two varieties. They sell clear, which I know this looks a little bit yellow, but it is clear. And then they sell beach glass. So if you want a frosted glass look, they sell a stick specifically for that. Those are the only varieties they have right now. They are dyeable. If you use, do I have it? I bet I do.
What is it called? Mod melts.
These are called mod melts. I will write it.
And you're from Michael's, right?
Yes.
There's a reason to go to Michael's. I said there's a reason to go to Michael's.
They are the only reason I go to Michael's. All right. And actually, if you go on our podcast, I'm all about science, and so I tried dyeing these several different ways just to see which one stuck. And I have used acrylic paints, I have used food coloring, and I have used resin dye. Resin dye works the best. It gives you the best color. It is most consistent. When you pour it into the mold, you just use a toothpick or a popsicle stick and mix it around real quick. That's it. And then it comes out that color. Also, do note, this stuff dyes your hands like nobody's business. So please be very careful when using resin dye. It is very potent stuff. I see a question. Yes?
What's the cost? Is it like crazy expensive?
I believe this is 10 sticks. I'm sorry, 16 sticks, and it is
$6.99. Yes.
And all the sticks are 10 inches. 10 inch stick, baby. But these last quite a while. These actually tend to work a little bit better than standard glue sticks. You don't use them up as fast. So they do last a little bit. The molds, however, are a little bit more expensive. They're $7 per mold if you buy the molds they have. You can also use silicone and make your own molds. Oh, speaking of silicone, I found another new thing. How many of you guys have heard of Sugru? Wow, okay. Sugru? My bad. Sugru. It is basically a silicone-based putty that you can do anything with. Literally, I've seen people use it for key covers, as adhesives, as molding materials, pretty much anything you could possibly think of using putty for. And Sugru is a little bit expensive. It's about $10 for a small package the size of paper clay, which is like that big.
So where is this stuff?
Sugru, you have to buy online. Okay. However, if you wish to make your own, it's made of silicone and cornstarch. And they call it Ugu, because you can't use the copyrighted name Sugru. So if you mix silicone and cornstarch, you get Ugru, which is basically Sugru generic version. And you can use it to add details to your armor because it dries flexibly. So if you want to curve it, it curves with you. And it dries hard. Not hard, but hard enough that it will take damage. Yes?
There was a question earlier about how to make the face mask. Could you use something like that to mold?
Sugru? I probably wouldn't want to put silicone caulk on my face, but you potentially could. So I won't say either way because I honestly don't know. Just it's not something I'd probably do myself, just because I'm not keen on putting things on my face, let alone face paint. Yes?
What she's asking about would be more in the realm of line masks.
And you can find a lot of information on light casting. They do make specific materials to make a cast of your face.
Yes, Max Kirkland. I wish I could have gone.
I
saw another question. Yes, no, maybe. Oh, right. I'm just making sure I catch everybody like in order. Yes.
The ratio for the cornstarch to.
Oh, for the oogreel?
Yeah.
1:1. If you want it to be a little more firm, you just add more cornstarch. If you want it to be a little more fluid, then you just add more silicone. I have been told you can use it for casting. So if you want to make a mold out of the stuff, you can pour it on something and make a silicone mold out of it.
I have a question. Where does one obtain silicone besides breast implants?
I would say from your local casting store, like Reynolds. Reynolds Casting is local. They are in Farmers Branch. You can go to Brick in the Yard. You can go to pretty much any place that sells casting material. I would also imagine some hardware stores sell it.
That silicone?
You potentially could use silicone caulk. What?
I think, what was that stuff? I had that too, that liquid nails stuff.
Yes, that is silicone.
That was 100% silicone.
Yes. Liquid nails is 100% silicone.
And it's sold in Home Depot, Lowe's, hardware stores.
I say experiment in the name of cosplay and science.
So it's, you're literally just using the do-it-yourself variety.
Well,
yeah. Sorry, my experience with silicone was all breast implants, so I just not me personally, but I used to work for a company that manufactured
the glue between layers of the pink insulation.
That was not the way I wanted to start.
Okay. I wasn't thinking simple enough. I was thinking of here, not no. I mean hardware, common, the common name as opposed to the breast implant.
You should be able to use silicone caulk. Yes.
Is it sandable?
Yes.
Suguru is
sandable. I have been told it is sandable. I've not actually played with Suguru myself. That is one of my experiments on my list that after Akon, after I collapse and then have time to take care of media stuff, I will be making all sorts of experimental things and freaking out my landlord. They don't have to know why my bathtub is blue and why my smoke detector keeps going off. Yes.
Just really quickly for really, really delicate, if you're doing something that's either like a piece of prop that's, it's just like almost like grill work.
Okay.
You put down hot glue. If you want something that's a little bit more flexible and a little bit more just crazy easy to work with, take a freezer paper, use the plastic coated side, and take fabric paint. And it's really easy because you can print out designs that are really easy to freehand. And
then you trace it.
And stick it anywhere you like and seal for it.
Yes, and that is a really good way of doing filigree work.
Yeah.
I have seen some people actually make their masquerade masks that way. You can do filigree work on the freezer paper if you print it out and use fabric paint to trace it, and then you peel it off. And then you can glue it back down. All right, painting and weathering. Sanding. Lots and lots and lots of sanding. How many people know about sandpaper grit? Quite a few. Okay. Grit is just a measurement of how coarse sandpaper is. The lower the number, the more coarse the sandpaper, that's what you will start with. Work your way up. So start low, go high. You'll find most of the sandpaper in the automotive and hardware sections of the store. You'll probably want to get several different varieties. Yes?
I was going to ask you about that. Do you prefer to have a large variety of grit, or just have a
I use favorites.
Go ahead.
I use 120 for starting. Sometimes I'll use 80, 120, and 220. No need to go any higher than 220.
I start with 80.
You're not doing a show car. Well,
yes.
Maybe you are.
Yes. Sandpaper will go all the way up standard grit to 2000. And they don't make it in individual numbers. It's not like you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They skip. Also, a mouse sander and or an orbital sander are your friend.
A mouse sander?
Mouse sander, it's shaped literally like a mouse.
Okay.
And you hold it in the palm of your hand and you go...
Yeah.
And keep a vacuum nearby when you're sanding because you'll make a mess.
Is a mouse sander electronic or is it...
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. It has either a cord or a battery, if you get cordless kind. It's literally about that big. I have one. I bought mine from Harbor Freight for $30. Well worth it. Well, I made one suit of armor, paid for itself.
What brand did you buy, though? Did you buy Black & Decker?
Yes, it was Black & Decker.
I may just have had one. Yeah, I've had a bad experience.
Almost all of my toys are Black & Decker.
Black & Decker really is kind of it is the cheap, the Walmart. You know, you're only going to use it for one project, don't spend a lot of money. If you want to do this a lot, go...
Spend the money.
Spend the money.
Yes.
I had a Black & Decker mouse. I got through with my first armor project, and it started making a really weird noise, so I took it apart. And I thought, oh, look, there's just this little piece of plastic that has sheared. I'll just call up the company and get a new part. They won't. We manufacture our products. We put them out so cheap on the market, we don't expect you to call for parts. We expect you to just go out and buy a new one for $30. And they're cheap enough you can, but I was pissed, so I spent $100, and I've never had to replace my tool.
This does not give me faith for the later life of my mouse sander.
Yeah.
I'm going to use it next time, and it's going to die. I'm going to be like, you cursed my mouse sander.
I'm sorry. It sounds like yours has lasted longer than mine, dude.
All right. Primer. Gesso.
Yes.
You've probably heard of gesso. And it is pronounced gesso, kind of like it's pronounced jif. Not
you. Yeah, let me see that. I don't think I've heard of it.
Gesso is a primer. It is used.
That's
you'll find it in the.
Yeah.
Well, it's an acrylic primer.
Okay. Sorry.
You'll find it in the artist section of stores, hobby stores.
You wanted to pass that around?
Yeah.
I'll have it. They can come up here and look at it at the end. But this will help, especially if you have foam to get paint to stick, because it is flexible. It is a flexible primer. You'll find there's different brands of gesso. I'm not fond of Liquitex, actually, because it has a little bit of a grainy finish. The good news about gesso is it is sandable. So if you want to prime it and then see if you've done a good job, sand it and then spray paint it, and you'll see where you've missed spots. I love gesso. Decide what kind of finish you want, matte or gloss. Do you want to be uber shiny for the cameras or just a little bit shiny? Because high gloss, you will be a lens flare on camera if you use a high gloss finish. A lot of people will use floor wax. Yes, you can use floor wax on your armor as a finish. And it does make it extra, extra shiny. But, you know, if you want the metallic look, it looks really good. Base color coats beneath metal. Yes?
What's the best way to add gloss to armor?
I'm a fan of glaze, which is just acrylic glaze. You can find it in any craft store. This stuff is very high gloss. It works like spray paint. Just spray them. One can of this will get me through one full suit of armor. And this is, I think, $4, so it's fairly cheap. I know a lot of people prefer to use the paste forms of wax, where you can actually literally buff your armor and make it glossy.
No.
So if you're willing to do it, you can get a really good finish on it. It's like buffing a car, just if you were wearing a car and you were a transformer. Yes.
No, that stuff you don't want to stay too long on a spot to get too heavy because
correct.
It will just run and then you've got to run.
Yes, and then you get the fun little droplet effect of gloss on your armor, and it's very hard to get that off. I actually have some props that have running drops, and it makes me very sad. As far as base coats beneath metal, if you ever look at real metal is not actually one solid color. So you can spray paint armor a single metallic color and have it look mostly metallic. If you want it to look real, you need to put a base coat underneath it of black. You can experiment with other colors. If you want to get a pink sheen armor, My Little Pony style, you can literally spray paint pink underneath it, spray paint silver metal on top, sand it. You will get an odd multicolored effect with it. And you can experiment with different colors underneath the metal to get different colored effects. So mix and match. It's a more realistic look. It is a lot more sanding, but it does give you a very neat effect. Yes?
Is that like just a flat, solid layer of black?
Yes. Yes, matte. This stuff. Yep, spray paint. I love spray paint, so I always buy it in cans. So
like
yes, flat black.
The shields over there, are those the way they're painted?
You want to talk about how you paint those?
No.
Okay.
This, did you talk about this? This,
yes.
I did this on purpose. Well, no, okay, I lied. I didn't. What really happened is I didn't finish in time. But I'm going to say that I did it for this panel. No, you'll see there's a huge difference here between the finish up here and the finish on the side and on. Okay, the back, let the light catch it, it's kind of dull. It is a metallic spray paint. In fact, I think it's the silver version of this. Yeah, it's the silver Krylon. Not nearly as shiny as it is on the can. Okay, so that's the silver Krylon. Silver Krylon is on this side and it's on this side. Up here, here, and here is noticeably different. Which one do you want?
I like the shiny.
The show, okay, so that's not paint.
Everybody likes the shiny.
It's not paint.
It's not.
This is not paint. I have never, I feel bad because every time you're showing off the paint, so I come behind you and say, I hate paint. Shiny. I want shiny, damn it. I want it to be shiny. No, this is
why I would like you to talk about it.
Okay.
So you can talk about the not so painting part, which I don't have experience with foiling things.
Yeah.
And there are foils and coatings now that you can use so that you don't have to paint. They're coming out with really awesome things for home decor, man.
Well, no, this is. Again, I'm going behind you. Say another one.
Go right ahead.
Yes, she's right. They're doing it for that. You can get the stuff in crafty stores, but it's been around for years.
No, I was thinking home
in the hardware stores. No. You can buy this in different colors, but if you're good with silver, just stick with your hardware stores. It's in the plumbing section. It's extreme weather foil tape. It's just HVAC tape is what it is. So for making repairs on like dryer vents or any kind of venting system for, yes? HVAC tape or extreme weather foil tape. It is aluminum. This is actually metal. But I've got an open roll here and it's, you can pass it around and just kind of look at it.
My handwriting is getting more and more messy.
This is a way to get, not only is it convincing, it is an actual metal finish. So that's why these areas are so much shinier than these areas. I wanted to finish this bloody thing and I didn't get around to it, so I figured, oh well, it's good for the panel. I can show them paint, tape. And then this is actually a little different. Now it's not paint. But it's not the exact same as this. It's not the same stuff. This is actually the blade is finished with a vinyl car sticker. Like people that do like racing stripes on their car or whatever. It's I'm not gonna lie, it's expensive. And I'm not gonna lie, this is you get what you pay for. You can spend you can buy a $6 can of spray paint. This giant roll of tape, which will last me a while, is $20. I want to say it's like $21 at Lowe's. So yeah, you're going to spend a little money if you want that nice of a finish. But it's very easy to use.
Yes.
If you're covering large areas with that, how would you hide the edges? That's what I was thinking.
Edges?
How did you do that?
I can show. Okay, so this, literally the application is kind of, it can be kind of tricky on edges. I just kind of cut mine with the blade.
No, I mean, you have to see. If you have a wide area that you have to cover with that tape, how do you hide the edges of the tape so it doesn't look like you taped it?
So
because that's only this
one. So you're doing a whole shield.
Okay,
like,
so here's a joint. This is kind of what you're talking about. Here's what a joint will look like where I had to butt two pieces up against each other. It will make a nice little line. You're going to have to incorporate that into your design. So that's why I cut my pieces so that this is one piece, there's a joint, this is another piece.
Okay, so you
this
can't just cover a big flat area and
you could, and actually you could do some buffing to sort of rough up to sort of detract from the look of the lines where the joints are. But unless you are, and you may be able to be skilled enough. Now I had a little bit of overlap here, but if you're very, very skilled and you can perfectly butt two pieces up next to each other without any overlap. The overlap is what's going to give you a line.
Yeah.
If you're skilled and you manage to get them right side by side and then you buff it out, it's probably not going to be that noticeable. I don't have an example of that. I knew I was going to have joints, so I... Here we go again. I knew I was going to have joints, so I just...
just brought on in, but I'm not sharing.
Decided to do that. Yeah, no, I knew I was going to have this, and I wanted it for the design, so I figured I'll put it here, you know, I'll probably put one here. So yeah, that's...
And the sword blade is vinyl?
The sword blade is a
it's
vinyl...
sticker.
It's a big sticker for cars. Pep Boys Auto is where I bought it. Actually, too, you know what? Since I'm not at all averse to doing this.
Yeah. How did you make it? Did it just meet up?
What?
The edge.
Oh, yes. The edges meet. I actually, I think I did a little bit of super glue to sort of seal it off so it didn't peel back. It wears off over time. The nice thing about this, just as you can repaint something. If eventually your prop looks scratched and beat up and, you know, you're deciding to want to make it all nice and shiny again, you can just peel it off, put a new one on. I've done that. This actually, I really need to redo it at some point, but I was gonna show you something else if I could get it started. Here. Yes.
We have 5 minutes.
Huh?
We have 5 minutes.
Oh, shit.
As you can see, there's quite a bit more to armor making than we can actually go in 2 hours. So with the 5 minutes left, I will open the floor to questions. I would like to say after the panel, you are welcome to come up and look at any of this equipment. I also have a book, Molding and Casting Handbook, in the back. It shows step-by-step how to make a vacuform machine. So if you want to page through this, you may have a look.
What's the name of that thing again?
You can come up and look at the end of the panel, but it's called Molding and Casting Handbook. It is yellow. This is considered the yellow Bible of prop casting and mold making. So you guys can come up and look at this at the end of the panel. Take pictures of the ISBN and whatnot. But otherwise, if we can keep it quiet just a little bit longer, I'd like to open the floor for questions. Yes? Yes. Or you can also take a rust-colored acrylic paint, water it down, and then watercolor it across parts of your armor, and then gently sand with a high-grit sandpaper so that it doesn't look quite so obvious.
So you would recommend watering down acrylic and not actual watercolor?
You could potentially use a watercolor. I simply prefer acrylics because they are stronger in color. I have to think about being on stage, so it has to be big and bold. Make sense? Yes.
I would say they actually make some kind of two-part spray thing that creates rust.
Oh, okay. Apparently they make a two-part spray that will mimic rust.
Miniature people use it a lot.
Okay.
Like on tapes and stuff.
Good to know.
Formulate.
Shh, guys. Yes.
What would be a good substitute for plate armor?
For plate armor?
Yes. Yeah.
I would probably say thermoplastics with rivets, which for those who have never seen a rivet gun, this is a rivet gun. These are called pop rivet guns, and mostly for safety reasons, I'm not going to demonstrate why, because it sounds like a gunshot, and I think I scared my neighbors the other day when I first used this. It's loud, but these are rivets. They look kind of like nails. And basically you put it in the end of here, and then you take the two materials you're going to put together, and you pull, and it will rivet them together. And the end of the rivet, this actually breaks off. And it will smush the rivet flat so it holds the materials together.
You will need that.
These are good to use if you want to get that metallic effect without actually using metal. And it's very sturdy. This was $12 at Harbor Freight. And it came with 120 rivets. Yes. Yes, it can. It actually comes with several different size noses so that you can use smaller rivets for them, if you want to. Yes, I am all about power tools. I'm going to have a garage soon. It's going to be full of power tools. Anybody else have any other questions for us? Yes?
What's the best way to
out of these? I am a big fan of magnets. And here's why. If I want my armor to have a very anime effect, I have magnets on the inside. You can see the magnets on the inside of the armor. like so. If I hold it up to me, put magnet under my clothes, right here, I can feel it. I'm trying to feel the edge. You can't tell where it's attached. And this is how you get an anime look. And see, I can move and it's not moving.
Because there's no fasteners in anime.
Correct.
There's just no way.
This is why I'm a fan of this. Because then all I have to carry around is just a short stick of magnets. And I know I never have to worry about them breaking. Because magnets don't break. If I can't have magnets, which I use rare earth magnets, you can order them at Magnets for Less. A stick of 100 is under $20. Neodymium. If I could not use magnets, which would make me a very sad person, the next on that list, I would probably choose strapping and D-rings, just because it is strongest. D-rings, oh yeah, I have magnets in there too. These are D-rings, they've shaped in a D, hence D-rings. And then, everybody's favorite from middle school, backpack strapping. You can actually go to the dollar store and just salvage this stuff off backpacks. I mean, for a dollar, that's cheap. You can get the buckles off of it, too. Sometimes if you go shop for buckles for this, they're called parachute buckles.
There's a question over there.
Yes? Yes. If you do that, may I recommend two things. Sew pockets into the garment, because there is no adhesive on this earth strong enough to hold a neodymium magnet in place. Not that I've found. Especially hot glue. And the other is that you need to make them removable for when you launder, because otherwise your garment's going to get stuck to the inside of your dryer and washer. You will not be able to pull it out. Or it will stick to itself and fold, and then you get a permanent crease after you've washed and dried your garment. Magnets are very strong. So, those things aside, yes. I have so many stories. I like it on the outside because it's easier to repair. So that if they ever fall off, I can just put it right back on. Because I do have to repair my armor periodically. You know, I just consider it a role-playing thing. Periodically, stuff breaks in games. Gotta fix it. All right. We are out of time. If you guys have any questions for us, you can come up and talk to us after the panel. Go to cospod.org for recordings of this panel. Otherwise, thank you so much for coming.